Good morning, guys. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So today we are going to discuss a lot of interesting questions which can be of use for your upcoming RBI, SEBI and NABARD examinations. So let's begin this video. But before beginning anything, let me announce that we are going to provide you the PDFs of the PPT of the sessions that we are taking on our channel from now onwards on our Telegram channel. So if you want to get the free PDFs of our sessions, then you can join the Telegram channel from the link given in description below. So that was the announcement. I hope that this announcement has cherished you a lot, because a lot of students were asking me about the PPT, the PDFs of the sessions. So now this would be a good news for all of you, because you will be getting the PDFs from the Telegram channel itself. Okay. On that note, let's begin with the video. But before that, do subscribe and hit the bell notification, because if you don't attend these sessions, then how will you get the PDFs? And these sessions are useful for your examination, guys, because NABARD grade A and B examinations are right around the corner, and we are providing you with a lot of interesting sessions. Like, I conduct the current affairs session at 10 a.m. on every Monday, Wednesday and Friday, so that you can revise your Spotlight magazine. And similar kinds of sessions are being taken by Anuj sir and Manish sir and other mentors on our channel as well. So you can watch those sessions without missing any one of them if you just subscribe and hit the bell notification. And this is that very Telegram group where you will get the PDFs. So the link of this Telegram group is in description below. Guys, you need to download the Telegram app first so that the link can work. Okay. I am saying this because I got a message from a student who was unable to open the Telegram group because I guess he did not have the app. So first you need to download the Telegram application, only then it will work in your mobile. Okay, so that was all about the information part. Now let's discuss the information that can be of use for your success. So the first question is, which of the following statement is incorrect about the Biotech Pride initiative? So this Pride stands for promotion of research and innovation through data exchange. So we have five options. It is administered by Department of Science and Technology. Biotech Pride aims to connect other existing biological data sets, data centers with the IBDC. This network will be called BioGrid. This BioGrid will be a national repository for biological knowledge, information and data. BioGrid will be responsible for establishing detailed modalities for accessing data. Currently, India ranks number 4 amongst the top 20 countries contributing towards biological data. So the right answer here is option A. This Biotech Pride initiative is administered by Department of Biotechnology under Ministry of Science and Technology. So do remember this thing. Now guys, you need to understand, why do we need such an initiative? So this Biotech Pride, the full form of Pride in itself is indicating the purpose of this Biotech Pride, or we can say the function of this Biotech Pride, not the purpose, because through this full form you can know that this initiative is for collection of data and exchanging that data. So that is the function. Now what kind of data will be collected through this initiative? The data related to biology. Now India is such a heterogeneous country, and it is such a vast country. We have different communities, cultures, people, tribal people also reside in India. Therefore it is very important for the government, for the research community, to understand the demography, the biological diversity in India. And in order to understand that, this Biotech Pride initiative has been launched by Ministry of Science and Technology. More precisely, Department of Biotechnology under Ministry of Science and Technology. Now let us understand the implications of this initiative in detail. So this we have already discussed. Now you need to know that a website of this Indian Biological Data Center was also launched, and this is the implementing agency for this Biotech PRIDE initiative. Department of Biotechnology is monitoring the initiative, is providing the support, is basically administering the initiative, but the agency which will be working on ground will be this Indian Biological Data Center. The next point here is that these guidelines aim to connect other existing biological data sets, data centers with the IBDC, and this network will be called BioGrid. So the network which will be created after connecting the existing data centers with the IBDC, that entire network will be called BioGrid. And why are we creating BioGrid? So that research in biological diversity of India can be done. Because if we have data, only then we can make appropriate policies. So that is the reason. Now this BioGrid will be a national repository for biological knowledge, information and data. Also, BioGrid will be responsible for enabling its exchange, developing measures for safety, standards and quality of data sets, establishing detailed modalities for accessing data. Now, who is going to access this data? What is being talked about in this point? Basically, accessing data refers to the research community who wants to access this data, because access to dena padega na researchers ko. If they won't have the access, how will they create solution? How will they study the data? So in order to develop modalities so that the access can be provided to the research community, and at the same time the safety of that data and the quality of data can be maintained, and that responsibility has been laid upon this BioGrid. IBDC will be the implementing agency of this initiative or the guidelines, and India ranks at the number 4th among the top 20 countries in the world that are contributing towards biological databases, that are doing research in biological data sets. So that was all about this Biotech Pride mission. Now let's move on to the next question. When will India and US launch the NISAR satellite mission? 2023 to 2024 2029 2030. So 2023 is the launch date. Earlier it was 2022, but right now 2023 has been announced by the government of India that it is the launch date for this mission. Remember guys, Gaganyaan and Chandrayaan 3 are the two missions that are planned for 2022. So do remember these two missions. They are very important and they will be launched in 2022. In the next year of 2022, ISRO will launch this NISAR satellite mission. Now let us read about the NISAR satellite mission. So this NISAR stands for NASA ISRO Synthetic Aperture Radar. So basically, let me first tell you what this radar is all about, what this mission is all about, then we will read these points one by one. So this mission is basically to observe the world. This is basically an Earth observation satellite mission. So what would be the purpose? To observe the different land masses of Earth, landscapes, vegetation, cryosphere. Cryosphere is the area of Earth that is covered with ice. So all the areas of Earth will be monitored through this NISAR satellite mission. Now, what is the specialty of this mission? Because this is the collaboration with NASA, that is one unique point. But apart from this, the uniqueness of this mission is that it is the world's first satellite mission, the world's first Earth observation satellite mission that has dual radars. That is the second uniqueness of this mission. And third uniqueness is that it is the world's most expensive Earth observation satellite mission so far. Now let us read some details about this mission. So it is a joint Earth observation mission between ISRO and NASA to improve the understanding of the impact of climate change on Earth's changing ecosystem, land, coastal processes, land deformation and cryosphere. So what is the impact of climate change on all these different areas of Earth will be studied in this NISAR mission. The next point is that it is a dual band radar imaging mission. And remember, guys, this is the world's first dual band radar imaging mission that is being planned, or that is being developed to be more precisely. It will have a capacity of full polarimetric and interferometric modes of operation. Now, this is not at all very important for you, nor you need to memorize these two terms. Not at all important. Now, what will this mission do? It will observe minor changes in land, vegetation, and cryosphere. So even the minutest change in these spheres will be observed by this satellite. Now, guys, the benefit of having the dual band satellite is that it is very precise. It gives high resolution images. It can work 24/7. It can work in all weather conditions, and it can work in cloudy situations as well, where the cloud is all over in the sky. So it can also take images even in that condition. That is why the ISRO and NASA are developing this dual band satellite mission, because two bands, so they are going to improve the efficiency of this satellite mission. Now, NASA is developing the L band. Ye hai synthetic aperture radar. SAR is for synthetic aperture radar and associated systems, while ISRO is developing the S band SAR. Now, guys, before reading this out, let me tell you that this S band aperture has already been developed by ISRO, and it has already been sent by ISRO to NASA. Now NASA will integrate this band with L band, and then after integration, this whole system will be sent back to India so that the further work on the satellite can be done. So the further work will be done in India itself. So ISRO will be developing this S band SAR spacecraft bus, the launch vehicle, and associated launch services. India and US had agreed upon the mission during the Barack Obama's visit to India in 2015. Now, let me tell you that according to some websites, the year in which this MOU was signed for developing this NISAR mission was 2014. According to some websites, but according to some other websites, which are very authentic and reliable sources, the year is 2015. Now, here I would like to tell you that the year of signing of this MOU is not very important in comparison to the year of its launch and other facts related to this NISAR mission. So here what you can do is you can just memorize that in 2015, when Barack Obama came to India, they both agreed upon on this mission, and the talks for having such a mission was started in 2014. So this is how you can memorize this thing. And according to the websites, as I have told you, both the years have been mentioned. So it is really confusing. You cannot choose between one year. But yes, as the things generally go on, usually the discussions related to missions and agreements start a year before, or 2 years, sometimes 10 years before the signing of the actual agreement. So it is probably the possibility that the discussions on agreement began in 2015, but when Barack Obama visited India, the official agreement signed in 2015. So that was all about this NISAR mission. Next question is very easy. Which organization has developed COVID Beep, India's first indigenous cost-effective wireless physiological parameters monitoring system for COVID-19 patients? So basically, it is going to assess the physiological parameters of the patients. Which organization has developed it? It has been developed by this ESIC, Medical College of Hyderabad, and apart from this, Department of Atomic Research also participated in developing this COVID Beep. So the main organization is this. It collaborated with this Department of Atomic Research for developing COVID Beep. And remember, it is India's first indigenous such tool that is going to assess the physiological parameters of COVID-19 patients. And it is cost effective as well. So that is why it is important for you to know that which organization has developed this technology. Moving on to the next question, who has won the Lokmanya Tilak National Award for 2021? So you have these five options, out of which option D, Cyrus Poonawalla, is the right answer. So Serum Institute of India, which is very much in the news because of the work it has done during the COVID duration, and precisely because of the work that Cyrus Poonawalla has done during the COVID pandemic and the contribution that he made towards saving the lives of people, because of those works, he has been given this award. So the Serum Institute of India was founded by Cyrus Poonawalla and he is the present chairman. Adar Poonawalla is the CEO of this SII. Okay. Now this award is a very prestigious award in India. It is given by Lokmanya Tilak Trust. And remember that there is a specific date on which this award is given every year. It is August 1st, which is the birth anniversary of Bal Gangadhar Tilak, who is popularly known as Lokmanya Tilak. So remember the date. August 1st is the date on which this award is given every year. But this year, it was postponed due to the COVID pandemic and it will be given on August 13. Now that is not something you need to know or remember, but it was just for your information. But do remember this thing, that there is a specific date on which this award is given. Now that was all about this Lokmanya Tilak Award. Moving on to the next question, who has won the Oscar of the Comic Book Award 2021 from India? So the right answer is Anand Radhakrishnan. So he is basically an illustrator from Mumbai. Now guys, remember that this award is also known as Will Eisner Comic Industry Award. So this is considered as the Oscar of the Comic Book Award. So Oscars of the comic world is the another name, or we can say the honor that has been given to this award. Now apart from this, you also need to know that this award is given at the San Diego Comic Con International event. So this is basically an event conducted in San Diego, California. So this is the place where this is held annually, and this is the very prestigious event in the field of comic books, or we can say the entire industry of comic books. So this is the international event that is held every year in San Diego, California, and at this event this award is given. Now, this award is given in many categories, and all those categories and winners are not important for us. What is important for us is this person, because he is an Indian and he won this award. Now, apart from this person, he is also sharing this award with John Pearson. So he is another illustrator with which Anand Radhakrishnan is sharing this award. He has been given this award for his illustration in Blue in Green book. So this is a comic book of a UK based author. And because of his illustrations in this book, Anand Radhakrishnan was given this Oscars of the Comic World Award. You need to tell me who is the author of this book. So this is the one and only question that I have asked you in this video. So do mention your answers in the comment section below, guys. And for today, that was all. Thank you so much for watching this video. And if you have liked it, then do like it and share it among your friends. Thank you.